It is good to see you this morning, and I've loved you from a distance today on purpose because I love you. I don't want to spread this joy that I've had the last 3 days with any of you. So if you think, well, he wasn't very friendly this morning, I love you. I really do love you all. So, and you should love me more for not spreading the joy. So, all right. But we are glad you're here. Amen. And we welcome you. We welcome some home that's been gone for a long time. We welcome some that are very new. Amen. Glad you're all here. Extremely excited that God has drawn you by His Spirit to be in this place today. There's no one here today by accident or circumstance or chance. You are here because God wanted you to be here, because He has something in store for you today. I believe with all of my heart that God has miracles in store for all of us here today. Because He's here, the atmosphere is rich for miraculous things to take place, because He is the God of miracles. Amen? We don't serve a God who had an age of miracles or an age of this or an age of that. We serve a God who changes not, who is the same yesterday, today, and forever. Hallelujah. So welcome to the presence of the Lord. Welcome to the body of Christ that gathers here at the Praise Center. And we welcome Him as well. Will you help me do that this morning? Lord, we welcome You in this place. We thank You for each person that You have drawn by Your Spirit to be in this place at this time. And Lord, we welcome You to move by Your Spirit to do what needs to be done in our lives. Lord, we didn't come here to just be entertained. We didn't come here, Lord, just to be a spectator. Lord, we came here because we believe You're here. And we believe that You inhabit the praises of Your people and that Your inhabiting power can change our lives. So Lord, let that be the truth today in all of us. Let us all leave here, Lord, better off than when we came in, because we've been with You as You've manifest Yourself through Your body. We give You glory, we give You honor, and we give You praise for what's going to take place in this place today. And we ask it all in the strong, powerful name of Jesus. And all of God's people said, amen and amen. Just before Brett comes to bring the announcements, if you are our guest today, hopefully you received one of these welcome packets. If you did not receive one of these and you're a first-time guest, will you please raise your hand so we can make sure we get one to you real quickly? If you did not receive a welcome packet. Okay, I need one right over here, gentlemen, if we can get one of those welcome packets. All right, Todd's going to take care of that. All right. And when you get that welcome packet, if you've already received that, inside there's an information sheet and prayer request sheet. That is very important to me personally, and it's very important to the church. If you would just take a moment to fill that out for us. And any prayer requests that you would like for us to pray about with you, we'll be honored to do that. So if you'll just take a moment to fill that sheet out inside there. And in just a few moments, when we receive the tithes and offerings, you can just place this in the bag, and it will get to the appropriate people, and myself included, and we will be able to pray for you and have that information. So thank you so very, very much for doing that. Thank you for being here. And let's give Brett some attention for the announcements, and then we're going to receive the tithes and offerings in worship, and then we're going to get our praise on. Amen. All right. Woo.
I don't know about y'all, but I'm excited to get my praise on this morning. So let's go through this fast and furious. Y'all ready? Buckle up. The pastor's next life discovery group will be held Sunday, March the 16th at 2 p.m. This group is for those that are new here to the Praise Center that want to learn more about this church and our God-given vision and mission, and to get to know our pastor a little bit more. Everyone is invited to sign up for this class, and please pay attention. This is also for those that aren't so new but have just never taken that class. So even if you've been here for a while and never taken the class, it's for you. Or if you're new here and you want to learn more, it's for you. The key is to sign up at the hospitality desk. All right, and that is for the Discovery Life group. All right. Sunday, March the 16th at 2 will be our Life Journey group as well, and this group is for those that wish to learn more about growing in your walk with the Lord and discovering your spiritual gifts. You can sign up for this class at the hospitality desk also. Attention all the men in the house. Reminder that the Wild at Heart study series continues this afternoon at 5 o'clock. If you've missed the previous meetings, it's not too late. Come on and join us. If you have any questions, please see Phil West in the back there or Travis Googe, who's in the cage. Wild at Heart is just awesome, I will tell you. Men, come on out. It's a good time. Okay, here's a reminder for today. The pastor will be meeting with his prayer partners today, immediately following the service in room 207. If you are interested in becoming one of the pastor's prayer partners, please contact Jack or Belinda Purpall for more details. Okay, and last reminder, after that meeting, there will also be a meeting with his leadership team, pastor's leadership team, and so if you are in leadership here at the church, you are asked to make your way to room 207 immediately following the service. Now it's time to give.
Amen. For those of you who have not been around here, we are bridging the gap this year in 2014, and part of that means that we are doing things to try to reach that age bracket between 20s and 40s. We're doing everything we know how to make that happen. God's already blessing that. We're already seeing results of that. You've seen some of the results on the outside as we're trying to upgrade the appearance of the outside to give a little bit of more curb appeal to reach that age bracket. And things are happening. We got a little bit delayed with the weather, which we have no control over. But I can assure you that this week is going to step back up, and you're going to start seeing the progress again this week. So we need you to give to that to help us make Bridge the Gap a reality. So above and beyond your tithes, if you would give toward Bridging the Gap, that would be awesome. And we'll continue to make progress as God is blessing and showing us favor. And he has indeed been showing us favor. People have done a lot of the work that would have cost hundreds, if not thousands of dollars for nothing so far. And we are going to have to spend a little bit, obviously. We, you know, not everybody is as generous as some of our own people. Amen. But that's okay. God has given us discounts. He's given us favors. He's showing us favor with people who don't even go to this church. So just because he's wanting us to get this done. Because he wants us to reach more people than we do. And I want to reach them with all of my heart. I don't want there to be anybody within the realm of this ministry to go to hell because we didn't give them the good news. Amen. So I'm going to do everything within my power to reach everybody I possibly can, and I need your help. I need your help. Will you help me? All right. Then our tithes and offerings need to be up to par, and then above and beyond that, we need to be given to Bridge the Gap. If you would just mark that, Bridge the Gap, your extra giving, then we'll know how to appropriate it. All right, you ready to worship the Lord with your giving? Amen. I am a worshiper. I was created by God to worship. Therefore, as an act of worship, I bring my tithes and offerings into your storehouse. Based upon your word, I know I will be blessed, although that is not the reason I give. I give with a grateful heart because I love you and I want to honor you by obeying your word as an expression of my faith. I trust you to open the floodgates of heaven and pour out so much blessing that there will not be enough room for it. I trust you to rebuke the devourer for my sake and to protect my finances. I trust you to honor your word and save my whole family, that they may serve you and walk in health and abundance. And as you bless me, I will bless others and give freely as you direct me. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. As you give, let's go ahead and begin to worship. Take this life.
Oh,
believe dry bones are walking. I believe the dry bones are dancing and singing and running and rising and overcoming this morning. Because there is none like you, Jesus. You have overcome the grave, Lord. Lord, you have overcome the sicknesses. You have overcome the giants. You have slain them all. Lord, you are victorious in this place. Lord, we relish in the fact that you reign, that there is none like you. We live to testify your goodness and your mercy and your grace and your love. Lord, we thank you for the fact that though we were dead in our sin, we were dry bones, you believed in us. You saw an army, God. You saw an army, and we rise. I said we rise, Brayson, and we rise, and we sing, and we dance, and we run, and we worship, and we testify, and we live like no other. We live in the victory that Jesus Christ paid on the cross for us. Amen. He gave his best for us, amen. Somebody make some noise.
Thank you.
reconciliation, our redemption, our salvation. You are good, God, and there's no one like you. We worship you today, Lord Jesus. We dance before you. We lift our voices and our hands and our hearts and our eyes to whom our help comes from. Our help comes from the Lord. Thank you, Jesus. You make the weak strong. You give sight to the blind, hearing to the deaf. Thank you, Lord Jesus, that you strengthen those who are down. You give us the oil of joy and gladness for the spirit of mourning and heaviness. We bless you today, Lord, for the exchange that's taking place in your presence. We're trading our sorrows. We're laying down our burdens and our sicknesses and our sins, and we're picking up the name of Jesus and walking in faith and walking in light and walking in the truth of your word. We are more than conquerors through him. We can do all things through him who gives us our strength. And the joy of the Lord is our strength. Thank you, Lord, for the joy in this place. And Lord, for those who can't be joyful because of whatever is holding them down, I pray that through your word that would be broken off. That, Lord, the strongholds would come down. Imaginations would be cast down. Every thought would be brought captive to the obedience of Jesus Christ. Let the anointing remove the burdens and destroy the yokes off of people's lives so that they too can dance, so that they too can lift their hands, so that they too can sing, Jesus, there's none like you. Help us, Lord, today. Honor your word. Stretch forth your hand and heal. Stretch forth your hand, Lord. Confirm your word with signs following, Lord. We fully expect your word to take root and to produce fruit. In Jesus' name, amen and amen. You may be seated in his presence. I want to talk to you today about Bridging the Gap, part two, from Fear to Faith, part two. If you were not here last week, you can go online, and our website is thepraisecenter.net. You can go there and you can click on the link to YouTube and you can watch the service there, or you can request a copy of the DVD or the CD, and you can see our tech crew back there. They'll help you retain those, get those things, just fill out the form for them. They're available to you. Last week we talked about imagining a life without fear, imagining being led by faith instead of being led by fear, and ruled by faith instead of being ruled by fear. Today I want to talk to us again about fear, and I give Max Licato the credit he needs for the books that he writes, Next Door Savior, Fearless, and one other one, I can't remember the name of it right now, but those books helped inspire me to bring these messages about overcoming fear, so we give the credit where it needs to be. And of course, I know he's led of the Holy Spirit when he writes, and I'm praying to be led of the Holy Spirit as I proclaim this word, and I'm praying you'll be led of the Holy Spirit as you listen. Amen. Let's read God's word together. It's quite a lengthy passage today, but if you will just read along with each other and we stay together as a group, we'll get there. And it's going to be some shouting stuff, but just kind of retain the shouting till the end if you can, so we can stay on track with the word, because I really want to get to this. It is not to angels that he has, let's read together. It is not to angels that he has subjected the world to come about which we are speaking. But there is a place where someone has testified, what is man that you are mindful of him, the son of man that you care for him? You made him a little lower than the angels. You crowned him with glory and honor and put everything under his feet. In putting everything under him, God left nothing that is not subject to him. Yet at present, we do not see everything subject to him, but we see Jesus, who was made a little lower than the angels, now crowned with glory and honor because he suffered death, so that by the grace of God he might taste death for everyone. In bringing many sons to glory, it was fitting that God, for whom and through whom everything exists, should make the author of their salvation perfect through suffering. Both the one who makes men holy and those who are being made holy are of the same family, so Jesus is not ashamed to call them brothers. He says, I will declare your name to my brothers. In the presence of the congregation, I will sing your praises. And again, I will put my trust in him. And again he says, "Here am I, and the children God has given me. Since the children have flesh and blood, he too shared in their humanity, so that by his death he might destroy him who holds the power of death, that is the devil, and free those who all their lives were held in slavery by their fear of death. For surely it is not angels he helps, but Abraham's descendants. For this reason he had to be made like his brothers in every way, in order that he might become a merciful and faithful high priest in service to God, and that he might make atonement for the sins of the people. Because he himself suffered when he was tempted, he is able to help those who are being tempted." Now you can shout hallelujah. Hallelujah. We talked about last week, one of the most incredible things to me, at least in God's Word, is the fact that he never whitewashes or covers what happens, even the hard things and even the mistakes of some of our greatest heroes. I'm glad God tells the truth. Like Abraham and Sarah, who Abraham is considered the father of our faith, yet he and Sarah got ahead of God and ran ahead and made decisions out of God's timing. What was the source of that? It was fear that God wasn't going to come through. Like he said, we know that Moses committed murder. Why? Because of fear. We know that David's adultery and murder, what was that? It was a result of fear of being found out. Gideon's cowardness when he was hiding in the wine press, and I love that story so much, and I don't want to get too sidetracked. I don't have time, but I just love that story. He's hiding in a wine press out of fear, and the angel says, "Hail thou mighty man of valor." I just love that. There wasn't nothing mighty or valor about that. He's hiding out of fear, and yet God called him a mighty man of valor. What is the point there? That God calls things that are not as though they are. He sees us for who we can be and calls us out to be who we are destined to be. Jacob's swindling is not covered up in Scripture or whitewashed. Thomas's doubting is there for all of us who have ever had to doubt. Peter's denying. Peter, rock, Petros, denying the Lord. Even when he tells of his family tree in Matthew, he includes Rahab the harlot. Why? Why does God do that? Why is the Word full of those kind of examples? Because we can't relate to perfect people. Show me somebody who's never blown it or either won't admit that they have. Grab your pocketbook and run. If they'll lie about that, they'll lie about anything else too. I'll show you somebody that can't be trusted. I can't trust someone to tell me how to get through life struggles if they act like they've never had one. If they've never been through anything, they're not qualified to help me through anything. But God doesn't whitewash or cover up his Word. He tells us that we have all sinned. All have sinned and come short of the glory of God. There is none righteous, no, not one. So there's nobody in here better qualified to tell somebody else how to get saved than us. Hallelujah. The phrase "I've been there" is the chorus of Christ's theme song. If he were to write a song, his theme song would, "I've been there for you. I've done that." To the lonely, Jesus whispers, "I've been there." To the discouraged, he nods his head and sighs, "I've been there." To the insignificant, he knows what betrayal is and false accusations are. From his humble birthplace to his final days, we see a Jesus who can clearly identify with us on every single level. But many of us, because of fear of rejection, because of the fear of feeling insignificant or the fear of not being good enough or whatever fear it may be, we've made choices that have covered up the real us. And we have accepted personality traits that are not really who we are. Somewhere underneath the cover-up, somewhere underneath the baggage, somewhere underneath the camouflage is the real us. waiting to be rescued. The super timid and the super forceful personality have the same root problem. It's fear. The super timid are afraid that they'll be rejected, so they just don't exert themselves or assert themselves. The super boisterous or the super loud or the super whatever, it's the same fear. They're going to take control so nobody can reject them. Both of them are suffering from the very same root. It's fear. Fear of being found out. Can I just go ahead and jump to the end? We'll come back. But Jesus already knows you. He knows everything about you. He knows the real you, and He loves you. He loves you. And He knows you're hiding just like Adam and Eve were hiding because of fear. He knows you're hiding behind the walls and the mask and the facade and the camouflage. He knows the real you that's underneath all that. So go ahead and just let it out. And the sad thing is, not many of the people you think you're fooling are being fooled anyway. They know the real you somewhere under there. You're not fooling anybody. Sort of like this. Watch this for a moment. Underneath the stuff that's covered you up from when you left us last time, there you are. Can't you hear God saying that this morning? Can't you hear God saying to you this morning, there you are, Tabitha. There you are, Colin. There you are, Joe. There you are, Nancy. There you are, James. There you are, Brenda. There you are, Brooke. There you are, Rick. Can't you hear God say, there you are? He sees through the cover. He sees through the facade. He sees through everything else. There you are. And I died for you. And I shed my blood for you so that you could be free from fear of failure and insignificance and not counting and not measuring up or anything else. You are accepted in the Beloved. You are redeemed by the blood of the Lamb. You don't have to fear of not being real. You can be the real you because He died for the real you. Hallelujah. Hebrews 2, 17 and 18 says, for this reason He had to be made like His brothers in every way in order that He might become a merciful and faithful high priest in service to God, that He might make atonement for the sins of the people, because He Himself suffered when He was tempted. He is able to help those who are being tempted. Are you struggling with feelings of not mattering? He knows how you feel. Are you on the lowest rung of the social ladder? He knows how it feels. He understands. Have you ever felt taken advantage of? He knows how that feels. He paid taxes to a foreign emperor. He's been there. Ever had family tensions? He's been there. He knows what that's like. Ever been falsely accused? Ever had your motives questioned? Ever had your character maligned? He's been there. He knows what that's like. Ever been let down by those closest to you? Isn't it the ones that are closest to you that hurt you the most? He's been there. Betrayed, denied, forsaken by the ones he poured his life into. The ones you give the most to are the ones who can hurt you the most. But it's not an excuse to quit pouring and quit giving. Amen. He's experienced it all. He experienced all the pain and the testing. Listen to this quote from the book called Next Door Savior from Max. It says, Jesus was angry enough to purge the temple. He was hungry enough to eat raw grain. He was distraught enough to weep in public. He was fun-loving enough to be called a drunkard. He was winsome enough to attract kids. He was weary enough to sleep in a storm-bounced boat. He was poor enough to sleep on dirt and borrow a coin for a sermon illustration. He was radical enough to get kicked out of town. He was responsible enough to care for his mother. He was tempted enough to know the smell of Satan and fearful enough to sweat blood. But why? Why would heaven's only son, why would heaven's finest son endure her earth's toughest pain? So that we could know, so that we would know that he is able to run to the cry of those who are being tempted and tested and tried. Philippians 2:6 says, who being in the very nature of God did not consider equality with God something to be grasped. This is talking about Jesus. But Jesus made himself nothing, taking the very nature of a servant, being made in human likeness, and being found in appearance as a man, he humbled himself and became obedient to death, even death on a cross. Therefore, God exalted him to the highest place and gave him the name that is above every name. We've been singing about that this morning. That at the name of Jesus, every knee should bow in heaven and on earth and under the earth, and every tongue confess that Jesus Christ is Lord to the glory of God the Father. Jesus humbled himself, suffered and died, rose again, and ascended to the right hand of God to give you not only eternal life, but to give you life abundant here and now, to give you a life of victory over sin, a life of victory over fear. For we do not have a high priest who is unable to sympathize with our weaknesses, Hebrews 4:15 tells us. But we have one who has been tempted in every way, just as we are, yet he was without sin. Glory to God. He is qualified as our high priest because he faced whatever you faced. He's gone through whatever you've gone through, but he came out victorious. The first man, Adam, failed the temptation. The second man, Adam, succeeded and won the victory for us in that he never yielded to the temptation. Therefore, he is able to be our high priest and to live and to intercede on our behalf and to pray for us even when we're tested, even when we're tried, even when we're going through it. We have an advocate with the Father who is standing at the right hand of God praying, don't let him fail. Don't let him go down. Don't let it destroy him. He's ever living to intercede for you and for me because he knows what it feels like. Hallelujah. Jack Hayford says, into this need of understanding, Jesus comes. Above all, wanting us to know that he does understand, his suffering has made him the one to whom we can turn to for understanding. We all need somebody that understands. We need somebody that understands our feelings. We need somebody that understands our vulnerabilities and our emotional and physical pain. We need somebody who can identify with our weakness of our flesh. We need somebody who can identify and understand our doubts and our angers and our lust, the temptations that tear at our heart and rip our hope. We need somebody who knows what that's like and who can say, I can give you victory for that because I bought it for you. I won it for you. I defeated the enemy. I destroyed the tempter. Glory to God. We need somebody that can help us. Ephesians chapter 1 says, praise be to the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who has blessed us in the heavenly realms with every spiritual blessing in Christ. Not some, not a majority, but every spiritual blessing in Christ. For he chose us in him when we earned it, when we became good enough, when we worked hard enough. He chose us in him before the creation of the world to be holy and blameless in his sight. In love, he predestined us for adoption to sonship through Jesus Christ in accordance with his pleasure. Somebody ought to underline that. If you're one of those people that underline things, you ought to underline that in accordance with his pleasure. You are his pleasure. You're not his object of wrath. You're his pleasure. And we'll do the praise of his glorious grace, which he has freely given us in the one he loves. Can we read this one together? Do we have that next verse, verse 7? Let's read it together. In him we have redemption through his blood, the forgiveness of sins in accordance with the riches of God's grace. In him we have redemption. Where does the redemption come from? Through his blood. The forgiveness of sins in accordance with the riches of God's grace. It's not even according to your remorse. It's not even according to your repentance. It's according to his grace. It's according to his blood. That's where your redemption lies. You can't get it because you deserve it. You can't work hard enough for it. You can't be good enough. He predestined it for you before you were even born. Hallelujah. What a Savior. Glory to God. We have this redemption through his blood. Jesus paid it all. It's all to him I owe, the songwriter said. Sin had left a crimson stain. He washed it white as snow. I didn't wash myself. I couldn't forgive myself. Not until he forgave me first. Then he gives us the grace to forgive ourselves. And if you've not ever done that, you need to. Because you're not bigger than God. And you need to quit trying to usurp God's place. If God is big enough to forgive you, then you need to be big enough to forgive yourself. Amen. Jesus paid it all. He loves us. Oh, how he loves us. Praise his name. Praise his name. I want to use an acronym here at the end here for HUMBLE to help us to realize what Jesus really has done for us all. What Jesus really has done for us all. So I'm just going to use the word acronym, HUMBLE, to help you remember it. The H stands for he helps us when nobody else can. He helps us when no one else will. Hebrews 4:16 says, let us then approach the throne of grace with confidence so that we may receive mercy and find grace to help us in our time of need. It's not self-confidence, it's confidence in him. We approach the throne of grace with confidence. Confidence in his blood. Confidence in his finished work. Confidence in what he has done. Not self-confidence. The U stands for understands as no one else can. He understands as no one else can because he's been there. He's sinless. He's pure. He ministers to us as only he can. He ministers to us as only he can. Others can help, and we do need Jesus with skin on a lot of times. It's good to bear one another's burdens. It's wonderful to pray one for another. All the one another commands are there, but ultimately it's Jesus that can minister to us like nobody else. Just one word from Jesus can change things completely. Just one touch from the Master's hand can change years of torture and torment. Hallelujah. Just one divine encounter with the deliverer and you can be set free. You may need some accountability, and you may need to walk that out, but I'm telling you, there is a deliverer who can set at liberty those that are bound. And there's not a pill for that, and there's not anything else for that, but there is a Savior, there is a Redeemer, there is a deliverer. He believes in us more than anybody else. He believes in us more than anyone else. Oh, it's incredible to have people that believe in you. Parents, believe in your children. Speak life over them and not death. Spouses, believe in your mate. Speak life over them and quit speaking death. It's great to have brothers and sisters that believe in you, but he believes in you better than anybody. He believes in you when everybody else stops believing in you. He'll believe in you when there ain't anybody else to believe in you. He still does. And he loves us perfectly. He loves us perfectly, unconditionally. And guess what? It's eternal. It's never going to die. His love is never going to stop. It's never going to wear out. It's never going to grow cold. And when we learn how to love each other with his love, then our love doesn't die out and our love doesn't grow cold. It's human love that dies out. It's human love that grows cold. But God's love, the agape, unconditional, perfect love of God, it carries on for all of eternity. And you need that in your life. You need that in your marriage. And he encourages us to come to him and rest in his completed work. He encourages us to come to him and rest in his completed work. It's finished. You don't have to do it. He's already done it. You can rest in all that he's accomplished for you. You can cease from your own labor of trying to measure up. You're already measured up in him. You already accepted in the beloved. He's already made you the righteousness of God in him. So you don't have to strive. You don't have to work for that. He's given you the gift of reconciliation. He's given you the gift of eternal life. He's given you the gift of salvation and redemption. And let me just tell you something this morning as we prepare to worship. Humility is not weakness. Humility is not weakness. Humility is power under God's control. And we need to follow Jesus' example. Jesus humbled himself. Jesus humbled himself and he was exalted to the right hand of God. We need to humble ourselves this morning and say, Lord, I've done my own thing long enough. I've tried and tried and tried and tried to measure up. We need to humble ourselves and say, God, I can't do it. I can't make it on my own. I can't make it. I can't measure up. I can't be good enough. I can't be trustworthy enough. I can't be faithful enough. I can't be anything enough. I need a Savior. I need a Redeemer. I need a Deliverer. I need a Healer. It's not even about my faith trying to get worked up to a level to receive. Lord, you already my faith. You're the author and the finisher of my faith. It's about trusting you, God. It's about trusting you. It's about leaning on you, Lord. And trusting in your name. Humble yourself under the mighty hand of God and he will lift you up. That's the word of God to us today. Resist the proud. God does. But he gives grace. He gives grace to the humble. Humble yourself. Cry out to God. I need thee. Oh, I need thee. Every hour I need thee. Praise his name. Would you stand and let's worship God? If the Holy Spirit leads you to move in any way to call upon him or to cry out to him, then you obey that.
poured out for all mankind. God's only Son, perfect and spotless one. He never sinned, but suffered as if
made a show of him openly. He has triumphed gloriously over him. So if you're struggling, if there's something that has authority, why don't you step out in faith in agreement with Jesus? And by stepping out in agreement, you're saying, I declare, Jesus, that all authority is yours. I declare, Jesus, all authority is yours. I stand in agreement with you that all authority is yours. And you can come and find the freedom that Jesus is offering here today. He died for all of those who have been held captive by fear. He came to set at liberty those that were bound. You don't have to leave with the same struggles that you walked in with today. You can leave out of here redeemed, free. Why don't you step in faith right now as we sing and just let God take that authority. Let him have the authority in your life. You declare it. You walk in agreement with him. I declare it, Lord, all authority is yours. All authority is yours. That's what you'll be saying if you come. If you step out, you'll be saying, God, all authority is yours. I give you the authority to change this situation. I give you the authority to fix this in my life. In Jesus' name. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus.
We will overcome by the blood of the Lamb and the word of our testimony. Everyone overcome. We will overcome by the blood of the Lamb and the word of our testimony. Everyone overcome. We will overcome by the blood of the Lamb and the word of our testimony. Everyone overcome. We will overcome by the blood of the Lamb and the word of our testimony. Everyone overcome. Savior, worthy of honor and glory, worthy of all our praise, you are the Savior, all the day.
never trusted Jesus ever, this would be a great day to begin your relationship with Him. All you have to do is step out. Somebody will meet you here and pray with you. You can receive Jesus Christ as your Lord and as your Savior. Have eternal life living inside you from this moment on. And there's still time for needs being met. Whatever your need is, bring it to Jesus this morning.
You have overcome. Hallelujah.
the grave cannot contain you, for you were the
There is indeed no one like you. Lord, I continue to pray for those who don't know you, that somehow those walls will come down through your grace and your divine intervention, that they too can sing the songs of Zion, that they will be able to rejoice with the saints in knowing that their heart is right with you, that they've been forgiven and redeemed. So Lord, for those who might be under the sound of my voice who've still yet to make that decision, I pray you would go with them, protect them, draw them by your Spirit, continue to woo them, continue to knock on their door. And Lord, I pray in Jesus' name that they would open that door and say, yes, Lord. Yes, Lord Jesus, come in. Thank you for this day. Thank you for being among us today. Thank you for the liberty that you have given to us. In Jesus' name, amen and amen and amen. Just before you leave, I want to embarrass somebody right quick, but I just want to introduce Austin and his wife, Mr. and Mrs. Austin Young. If you would just step right down here and let everybody see you just for a second. Where did he leave? Where'd Austin go? Oh, well, I really am embarrassing. He's not here. I'm sorry. He was here earlier. It's okay, but they got married here Friday, and I just wanted to introduce them to you and let you know that they made that happen. Amen. God is doing a lot of things that you don't always see. You don't always know all the workings that are going on because we don't tell our left hand what our right hand does sometimes, but deliverance takes place around here a lot of times when you don't even know anything about it. Miracles take place around here a lot of times. You don't know anything about it because it's none of your business. Unless they decide they want to testify and tell you those things. I see her hand. I'm going to get to it in just a second. Was I talking while you were interrupted? I'm so sorry. No, go ahead. Paul Young, he chose church and stuff. Amen. Understandable. Why don't you pray for them right now, our youth leaders? All right? Yeah, I know. This ain't time to catch up on your prayer life. You're praying for Seth.